Hey there, my name is Xavier, and I've got an interesting puzzle for you. Imagine you're a farmer, and on the local market, you bought a sheep, a wolf, and a cabbage. Kind of a strange situation, but just go with it. On your way back home, you have to cross a river with your boat. However, there's a catch. The boat is only big enough to carry you plus one other item. And to complicate matters even further, you can't leave the wolf alone with the sheep because the wolf will eat the sheep. Likewise, the sheep will eat the cabbage if you leave them unattended. This is called a river crossing puzzle, a type of transportation puzzle, and it's a relatively simple one. You can probably solve it with a minute or two of thinking. So go ahead, pause this video, I'll wait right here. It probably didn't take you too long for you to realize that you have to take the sheep across first, because the wolf won't eat the cabbage. Then you go back to fetch the wolf. But since you can't leave these two unattended, you take the sheep back across the river. Then you take the cabbage across because the wolf won't eat it, and finally you go back to fetch the sheep. Ta-da! All of your purchases have now made it safely across the river. Because this puzzle is so easy, we can solve it by using trial and error. But how do we know that the solution we found is the only one? And how do we solve more complicated puzzles? Our guesswork isn't very scalable and becomes even harder when we add more variables to constrain the puzzle. So instead, we can use something called graph theory, a field in mathematics which studies graphs. A graph is a representation of elements that are connected with lines. Each element is called a node, and the connection between them are called edges. Now let's solve our puzzle by using graph theory. We'll start by writing down all the valid states for our puzzle. The starting state is simple. The farmer, sheep, cabbage, wolf are all on one side of the river. The desired end state is also easy. All of them have to be on the other side of the river. From there, we can for instance start by transporting the sheep across the river. We can do that because the wolf won't eat the cabbage, and we can travel back as well because the sheep is fine by itself. The inverse of these two states is also valid, so we can write those down as well. Now let's go back to state 2. From here, we can transport the cabbage across and leave the wolf alone. Just like before, the inverse is valid as well. But now we have a problem. We can't leave the sheep and cabbage alone, so we have to take one of them back with us. If we take the cabbage back with us, we end up in state 3. So let's take the sheep back across instead. And once again, the opposite situation is valid as well. And that's it. That leaves us with 10 valid states for our puzzle. Now we can start constructing our graph. We'll start by creating a node for each of the possible states, and then we can connect two nodes if we can move between these states. So our first node is number 1, where everyone is on one side of the river. From there, we can only go to state 2, because we can't leave the wolf with the sheep or the cabbage with the sheep. Then we can only go to state number 3, where the farmer goes back across the river. But now he faces a choice. He can either go to state 9 and take the wolf across, or he can go to state 6 and take the sheep across. From there, both routes have just one state they can go to until they converge together on state 5. And finally, they end up in the desired state. What we drew here is a simple graph, and it clearly shows us that there are two solutions to our puzzle. Now it's important to note that this is not a directed graph, even though I used arrows to connect two nodes together. We can always move back and forth between states, but doing that won't get us any closer to the desired end state. So we solved our puzzle by using graph theory, but where did it come from? Well, it started in 1736 when Leonhard Euler became fascinated by a game that the citizens of Konigsberg were playing. The city is built around the river and had 7 bridges that connected the different parts of the city together. Citizens were trying to walk around the city by crossing all 7 bridges, but never crossing the same bridge twice. Euler wanted to solve the problem by using mathematics, and he started by reformulating the problem in more abstract terms. He stripped away all of the information that isn't necessary, like for instance the path you take on land. Only the sequence of bridges you cross is important. So you could translate the city into this graph, where each node represents a landmass and the edges represent the bridges between them. Euler also realized that each node in the graph needs an even number of edges for the puzzle to be solved. The number of edges that a node has is called its degree, and it makes a lot of sense that these have to be even to solve the puzzle. When there are two bridges towards a particular part of the city, you need two other bridges to leave it again if you want to travel across each bridge just once. However, not all of the nodes need to have an even degree. If you have nodes with an odd degree, then your path has to begin at one of them and end at the other. In this particular situation, there are four nodes with an odd degree, so you cannot walk across the city and only cross each bridge once. Our puzzle has no solution, and Euler was the first to prove it mathematically. Because his work kickstarted the field of graph theory, other researchers gave a name to the path that goes through all of the edges without visiting the same edge twice, a Eulerian path or Euler walk. One interesting side fact, here we are visualizing a graph by using circles and lines to represent nodes and edges. The way you represent them, however, is not important, and in fact, visualizations aren't even necessary when studying graphs. Euler himself didn't draw any graph in his original paper. Kind of a bummer that we can't solve the Konigsberg problem. However, since Euler's paper, the city has changed substantially. During a bombing in World War II, two of the seven bridges were destroyed, and later, two others were demolished. An updated graph representation would now look like this. Two of the nodes now have a degree of 2, while the remaining nodes have a degree of 3. That means that we can now walk across all of the bridges without crossing the same bridge twice. That is, if we begin on one island and end on the other. So with graph theory, we can solve transportation puzzles. But what else? Well, how about navigating around a city? Navigation software like Google Maps uses a graph to represent the road network and calculate the fastest route to your destination. Each road is represented by an edge that has a certain weight. This can be the travel time or the distance of the road. Finding the shortest path between point A and point B can then be solved by applying a graph algorithm like A star or Dijkstra's algorithm. Or think about social networks who use graphs to visualize the friendships between people. Or cryptocurrencies like IOTA who use a directed acyclic graph to store transactions. More about that in this video right here. To summarize, graph theory can be applied to a variety of topics and can be used to solve interesting problems. So that was it for this video. If you found it interesting to learn more about graph theory or about farmers who make weird purchases, hit the thumbs up button or consider getting subscribed. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.